has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite, with all the never get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Good morning and welcome to Lord of Life. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us open with our prayer of the day. O God, our defender, storms rage around us and within us and cause us to be afraid. Rescue your people from despair, deliver your sons and daughters from all fears, and preserve in us the faith of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. This morning, the scripture we're going to focus on continues in Matthew, the 14th chapter, beginning with the 22nd verse. If you remember last week, we left off with Jesus abundantly feeding 5,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fish. It was the time that we discussed that Jesus had just heard the news that his cousin John the Baptist had been brutally killed by Herod, and Jesus was trying to get away and have some personal time to grieve, and he saw all the crowds following because they heard the horrible story, and they came in pursuit of Jesus because they wanted to be with him. So thousands of people came. Jesus had compassion on them, and he went to them, and that's when he fed them with the 5 loaves and 2 fish supplied by a little boy. So what happens after that? That's where we pick up today in this great story from the book of Matthew. We continue with the reading then of the gospel for today. The gospel is from the 14th chapter of the book of Matthew, beginning with the 22nd verse. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd that had gathered. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone. And the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves caused by the wind that was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said. And they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid." "Lord, if it is you," Peter said, "then tell me to come and walk with the water to you, to walk on the water to you." "Come," he said. And then Peter got out of the boat. He walked on the water and he came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and he caught him. "You have little faith," Jesus said. "Why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the gospel of our Lord. The scriptures today talk about the sea. Now, in the Old Testament specifically, but continuing into the New, the sea is always a metaphor for chaos. It's always a metaphor for trouble. So it's like the picture a turbulent sea that is reminiscent of times in our life that seem so upside down, times that in our life that seem out of control, much like being in the turbulent seas of a raging storm. Storms, unfortunately, are a part of our life. They represent times of struggle, times of uncertainty, and storms bring with them several human emotions, anxiety, fear, and of course the constant companion, doubt. In the story of creation in Genesis, when we find that Adam and Eve had fallen to temptation, it says in the scripture in the third chapter that God walks to them in the Garden of Eden in the cool of the day. So we know that was evening. So picture God walking to them, and it was probably something he did quite often. So he's walking to them, and they're not coming out running toward him this day. So he says, he hollers out, he says, Adam, Eve, where are you? Well, God, of course, knew where they were. But we believe why God is asking this question is he wants Adam and Eve to understand where they are. He wants them to recognize what they have done, that they've fallen into temptation, that they've fallen into sin. And it's more important for God that they recognize where they are. God knew where they were. And it's interesting to hear Adam's response. Adam comes out of hiding and he says, Lord, we were hiding. And God says, why were you hiding? And Adam says, because we are afraid. To be human is to experience fear. And sometimes we feel like in life we're afraid of a lot of different things. We can be afraid of the future at times, especially if we're faced a time of uncertainty, perhaps with a job loss or something like that. Sometimes we're afraid in life when we're going to a doctor's office to get a simple physical and something doesn't seem right and he sends us for continued testing. Sometimes we'll get on line now and we go to WebMD or something like that. I've heard many people do that, and they get all these different possibilities of what could be happening to us. And what they cause us to do is to fear and cause us to worry and cause us to doubt. And all of these emotions have really no place. That's not what God wants us to do. God wants us always to trust and to trust in him. But to experience fear is a very human experience in life. St. Paul, for example, in the letters that he wrote to the church in Corinth, it's in 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, which means his first letter to the church in Corinth and his second letter to the church in Corinth. He talks about fear. He talks about himself that as they were going to that church in Corinth to visit the people and to encourage them and to lift them up, he talks about the fears that he has, and he says, my fears are within. Meaning a lot of times, and that's where we keep them. I know that for myself, when I'm experiencing times of fear, times of worry or doubt, I tend to be very quiet. And I know my wife has come to recognize that particular emotion in me, and she knows that when I'm quiet, usually it's because something is going on, and it's going on within me. And it takes me time to come out of that, because I have to come to reason with a lot of different things. And usually what always happens is it's prayer. It's asking God to help me that finally gives me comfort and gives me peace. Oh, that we would always just turn to God first. And I keep telling myself that over and over and over, to start there instead of starting with the doubt and the fear and the worry and all that wasted emotion, and focus instead on God first and not on those wasted emotions. Over and over again, that is the simple and positive message of the Bible, is to fear not. When Abraham was Abraham and Sarah, when God called upon them to leave their home in Iraq and come to what is now the promised land in Israel, he calls them to go there. And as they were going there, they became afraid. And God himself is assuring Abraham. He says, fear not, for I am your shield and I am your salvation. When in the book of Exodus, when Moses is leading the people out of the captivity of slavery in Egypt and taking them to the promised land, if you remember, finally the Pharaoh says, okay, take them and be gone. So the people are all leaving and they're going, and all of a sudden, the Pharaoh changes his mind. And he sends the soldiers after them. And they're traveling and they want to capture the people of Israel and put them back into slavery. Right when all that is happening and the people turn around, they look and they see the military approaching them, they see a huge obstacle that has confronted them. It's called the Red Sea. And if you remember Moses, he lifts his rod up and he prays to the Lord and he asks God to free them and to open the waters, and God does. The waters are parted and all of the people are able to walk to freedom. The waters close back up and they are led on to safety for their journey to the promised land. Over and over again, even Mother Mary, when she was pregnant with Jesus, the scripture tells us that she trembled with fear. And it was the angel that said to her, "Fear not, Mary, for you have found favor with God." Over and over again, 70 times in the Bible, it talks about fear, and it encourages us not to dwell and not to fall into this temptation, because it is negative, and it usually, what do they say, 90% of the things that we worry about never ever happen. It's really a wasted emotion. And so we start with our focus on today's lesson, and we hear the story about Jesus finally getting a chance to go off by himself and to pray and to talk with God and to grieve his cousin John's death. And while he's off on his own, he finally is done, and he's getting his strength back, and he heads down the mountainside, and the disciples are on the Sea of Galilee, and they're almost in the middle of there, let's just say. We don't know exactly, but they were a good way off in there. Now, it's dark, pitch dark. It's in the middle of the night, and back in those days, remember, there's no benefit of any lighting at all. So dark is really, really dark, and if you can imagine a storm raging, the storm is raging, and their boat is on the turbulent sea, and it causes them great fear, and Jesus isn't with them. He's not there. And they really are worried that what's going to happen to us? Is Jesus going to help us? Is he going to come? And then we are told that they see Jesus. At first they think it's a ghost, but Jesus is walking on the water to see them. And now here's where the story gets even better. Peter looks at Jesus and he says, "Jesus, if that is you, bid me to walk on the water and to come to you." And Jesus says, "Come." Now, it's interesting. Peter gets out of the boat, and he does. He starts walking on the water. He's able to do what he shouldn't be able to do. But he's looking at the Lord, and he's able to do it. It's that God-given strength and ability that God gives to each and every one of us, and Peter is able to do it. But after a while, we don't know how many steps, but he gets to a point where he realizes, "Wait a minute. I shouldn't be able to walk on water. What am I doing here?" And he starts to sink. And he holds his hand up, and Jesus grabs him and saves him. And what does Jesus say to him? "Oh, you of little faith, why do you doubt?" Jesus calms the storm, and the disciples all get into the boat. Now, Peter always gets a bad rap, it seems, for not having the faith. But remember, the other 11 disciples stayed in the boat. At least Peter got out of the boat. At least Peter tried to come toward the Lord. At least Peter was showing his faith in God and his faith in Jesus. And even though he failed, they were starting, all of them, all 12 of them, to understand the power of God and that God was with them and the love of God and Christ with each and every one of us. That was their lesson that they were learning for 3 years. Jesus was teaching them that before Jesus would be crucified and taken up to heaven and the disciples would be on their own. So this was a very important lesson for them to learn today. And you stop and you think about it, and in the Gospel of Matthew especially, the church is a metaphor, the boat rather, is a metaphor for the church in the world. And the sea, again, is always representing chaos. And we even have a stained glass window over on the side. You can't see it from there, but it's a boat. And it's a sailboat with a cross on it and a turbulent sea. And that represents a church being the calm in the storm. And being a church here at Lord of Life, I have been your pastor here for 21 years. I remember when I first came, this church was a mission redevelopment church, one of 13 across the country, that basically the bishop said, we have more churches than we have pastors. So either this church has got to grow or we've got to close it, and we'll send you to another church. So we had 3 years, we had an edict, this church and the other 12, to grow it or close it. So we knew we had to bring about some changes in order to make that happen, in order to bring growth. So as I came in here, we were doing many different things, and I remember one thing in particular. Money was always very tight with us, and we were doing our best to help the people to understand faith and to grow and to help us to bring people to worship here at the church. But one time I went to a ministerial meeting, and it was one of the pastors. We get together once a month, all faiths in this community. And one of the pastors was talking about the need to have like a community meal for those in Livingston County that are hungry, that aren't getting enough food each week. And some of the ministers were barking back, "This is Livingston County. It's one of the most expensive counties in the state of Michigan. There's no homeless. There's no need like that here." And I remember I spoke up, even though I was new. I said, "We don't know until we try." So we were one of four churches that began what's called Fish and Loaves here at this church, and in our community now, we call it Fish and Loaves, in remembrance of that little boy that gave 5 loaves and 2 fish, but it was enough to feed them all. So we took our turn once a month. We would have a community meal on a Sunday night from 5 to 6:15. And so it would be a simple meal, and I remember coming to the Board of Ministry here and telling them that this was a project that I wanted to take on, and they said, "Dale, how are we going to pay for it? We're just barely making it." Do you know what we came up with? We came up with the idea of a can and bottle drive ongoing. So we asked the congregation, we told them what we wanted to do, to provide a meal once a month for the people in the community that were in need. And so we asked people to bring in cans and bottles if they could, and it would go to support that. Consequently, they did, and it's been 15 years that we have been feeding. We feed on average maybe 50 people that come here for Fish and Loaves for a meal on Sunday night, and they go to other churches. And now we have a total of 6 churches in our community. So it's about once every 6 weeks that we open our doors and we feed anybody, people of all faith or no faith at all, but we feed them. And that's what the church is called to do. We don't get any support. We don't get any government support. Churches are all on their own. The only support that we get is from the people, the faithful people that come to worship. They give. And it's with that giving that we try to be good stewards. And we have a board of ministry that works closely with me as we try to figure out the needs in this community. I remember we have like a Charlie Brown Christmas tree, we call it. We have it in the back of the church. And we always set it up for the weekend of Thanksgiving. And on that tree are ornaments, but these are special needs ornaments that we get from people in the community, from the various agencies that are people in need. So they're asking for a gift for Christmas. Sometimes it's underwear, sometimes it's a truck, sometimes it's a pair of pants or gloves or a dress or something. But anyway, the tree is filled with these ornaments with the size approximately or the age of the child. Do you know that this last year we were able to deliver over 50 different gifts to people in our community in need? So this is how we are trying to be the calm in the storm in the community in difficult times. We at the church here are doing our very best to bring encouragement and hope to people, and we are doing our best to continue to grow. We added another building on here, and that was quite costly for us. But back in the day in 2006 when we added it on, there was many people saying, "No, don't. We're just barely making it." We've always kind of just been making it, and that's okay. But do you know when we finally added that building on, now we have a daycare that is in there each and every week, every day, Monday through Friday, 6 in the morning till 6 at night, and they have over 100 children in that daycare, and that provides a need in the community. If it weren't for that daycare, there'd be many people that wouldn't be able to work each week because they're able to drop their children off in a nice, safe environment. I understand those feelings. I understand those fears because I used to be a single parent myself, and I needed to seek and to find a very good, loving daycare to put my son Ryan in. And so I understand that need, and I'm very proud of this church and what we're able to do. And a lot of times it's on a shoestring budget, but you know what? The Lord has always provided, and we are doing our best to be that ship that's in the maybe in the storms of life as we're going through the coronavirus now and other things. We're trying to be the voice of reason, the voice of faith, and the words of Christ. We're trying to remind people about the love of God, that God is here, and no matter how tumultuous the storms may be that you are facing, that we are facing together, none of them are any match for the love of God that He has for each and every one of us. That is our faith, and that is our belief, and that is our sermon for today. Amen.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite, with all the never get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time, 'cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. When Moses had stage fright, and David brought a rock to a sword fight, you picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. For the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.